I've never seen so much media, mate. That's the first thing. Secondly, look, you know, as a kid, I grew up watching the Six Nations on ABC in Australia, which is the equivalent of BBC. And it was, you know, the giants of the game playing the game. And I've still got memories of JPR Williams, Phil Bennett's, Colin Deans playing for Scotland. You know, those great players. And so you've got this tournament that's full of tradition. It's full of emotion. You know, the rivalry between all the countries is immense. So to be part of it's a great honour and very humbling. Well, you know, at the moment, probably the Southern Hemisphere teams are maybe 3 to 5% better than the Northern Hemisphere teams. That can change in 8 weeks. You can turn that around in 8 weeks. And the greatest championship doesn't relate to the greatness of the teams, it relates to the greatness of the competition, I think. The Six Nations is about contest, isn't it? You know, it's a contest in the set piece, it's a contest at the breakdown. It's never been a tournament known for its continuity, has it? Now, until the last day last year, everyone decided to throw all the toys out and it was all about continuity. Now, so the reality is, the start of this Six Nations is going to be about contest. And contest is about set piece. So, you know, we've got a lot of work to do in that area, but I believe that with the talent we've got, we can get back that fear factor of England of having that dominant set piece. Well, we've got an idea of the team I'm going to play against Scotland, and those guys aren't in that team at the moment. For each player, there's a reason for it that I've explained to them, and I'm not going to explain that to you, because that's between the player and myself. So the press doesn't pick our team. I pick the team with the coaches. And we feel we've got the best 23 to go up and beat Scotland. Well, it's Cotter Cup game. Scotland are the form side of Europe. They're playing at home. You know, the weather's probably going to be sunshine and 3 degrees, 30 degrees, beautiful conditions. So we know it's going to be a tough game up there. So I've got to pick a tough side to play up there. And then I worry about the games after that. Now, we're picking 23 to do battle at Murrayfield. I can't worry about it, mate. If I worry about time, it takes away from the time I got with the team. We had a fantastic day yesterday. We got through a lot. We worked out all of our plays coming out of our 50. Now, once we get in the 50, we've got to work out how to score some points, so we might do that today. As long as they keep learning, they've got a great future. Every player who's come into camp, they've all got areas they've got to improve on, and now it's how hard they work on those areas. You know, none of them are international players at the moment. You know, the difference between being a good club player and an international player is, again, if I go back to that 3 to 5%, but that 3 to 5% to get better is hard work, and it takes application and sacrifice. So those young players are enormously valued, but they've got to work hard and they've got to keep learning. And I'm pretty confident they will. You know, some players, as the guy said before, have had a disappointment. Now, how they take that disappointment, how they turn that into improving their game is the key thing I want to see. You know, all the time. You know, when we've got a team in camp, we're testing the players because we've got to get the players right to play Scotland at Murrayfield in front of 80. How big's Murrayfield? 65,000 Scottish people are going to be going crazy. You know, and that's pressure. That's pressure when you're there. So we've got to equip the players with the skills to be able to cope with that. And that's in how you develop a great team. And for young players, they're not used to that. So they've got to go through various tests to prove how much they want to play for England and how capable they are playing for England. That's super important. You know, in terms of athletic ability, all of them have got great athletic ability. But rugby's not played by athletes. It's played by rugby players who have got athletic ability.
Good. That's the easy bit. This is the difficult bit. Getting the boots on, getting out on the field with the boys. Everyone was excited. Energy was high. We had a couple of really good sessions. And like Eddie says, just keen to get back and get stuck in later this afternoon. Yeah, first and foremost, myself. To get back into the team and you know, my role within the team. Iddy obviously wants a dominant set piece. And for me, that starts at scrum time, being the leader of that scrum. And we've got Steve Borthwick running that line out, and geez, his standards are pretty high. So we've been well drilled there. And yeah, we want to be a dominant force up front, certainly. I'm confident. I'm experienced with my club. I've played in big games there, and I've done the role for 6 years. I'm fine with the role. I've got good people around me, got good coaches, good senior players. I've got good young fellas bringing energy. So it's just exciting for me. Yeah, I mean, that is a huge role, bringing on guys like that, but I've got to worry about myself. It's my first run out for England and since last year's Six Nations, so all my focus at the moment is on me as a player, being the best I can in that team. And hey, just naturally in training, you bounce ideas with guys, you coach, even young fellas. I'm not the finished article, I need help. So we had a good hit out yesterday, did some good set piece stuff. Both Luke and Jamie are very passionate about scrummaging, so I won't go into the details of it, but we had a good little chat. But yeah, going forward, I love that mentor sort of role, so if I can help them, I will. For me, again, getting in the team and doing my job as well as I can. That's the essence. Play well.
Well, he's got a new role, so he's learning his new role. He's doing that very well. Yeah, I think he can finish the series as a leading blindside flanker in Europe, and that's his target. So he's got a lot to work on. He's working hard. He's helping support Dylan. Yeah, he's a good fellow, Chris, and he's shown by his form with Harlequins that he really wants to play for England.
Have you chosen a vice captain?
Not yet. Maybe on the car on the way back.
Who?
Something.
Is he up there? Is he? I haven't seen him. Have you seen him?
I can't read it.
I haven't seen any Arnold Schwarzenegger quotes up there. Yeah. I'm not a big fan of his movies. So he definitely won't be there. We're starting afresh, you know. In a lot of ways, we've put a new coat of paint on the place, and what it stands for is the players. You know, the players stay at the hotel, and the hotel's a nice five-star hotel. That's where they relax. But once they step into the training centre, it's about business. So we want the players to be involved in setting up the training centre. You know, they've already got little projects to go on with in how they want the training centre to be, because it's their place of work. You know, the framework's there. It's an outstanding facility. You know, it's a world-class training facility, and we've got to make sure the players maximise their time there. I think, you know, Ireland played some lovely rugby under Joe Schmidt. You know, Sexton's a very shrewd and skillful operator at 10, and the way they use their resources is very smart. You know, Wales have got that uncompromising fitness aspect where they just keep at you all the time and they're never out of the game. Yeah, they're the two teams from watching from afar that have been impressive. It's fantastic, isn't it? So tight head prop Hataki's up in Newcastle.
Yeah.
Has he played yet? Okay. No, well, I think it's a great acknowledgement of Japanese rugby that players have come in. The number 8's gone to Bath. Make sure you go and watch him play. He can play. He can definitely play the game. He's an exciting player. Yeah, he'll tear the premiership apart if he gets fit and gets selected. Catching a teammate's like, you know, the first couple of days is like, remember, are you married?
I'm not, yet.
Okay, you got it ahead of you. When you first get married, you go on a honeymoon. Honeymoon's not like real life. Yeah, anyone who's married knows that. Married life is tough. You've got to take, you've got to give, you've got to make compromises. You've got to work out a way to make things happen. You know, when I stand up in the team the first time, everyone's sitting there nodding and saying, yes, yes, of course they are. But I know that's not the real situation. I know we're going to have our differences. Team's going to have differences between you, myself.
But we'll work that out and we'll find a way to make the team successful. So it's a nice honeymoon at the moment.
Well, initially, it's just going to be the coaches work with the team. You know, at the moment, we're assessing the squad. I haven't worked with the players before, so I need to get to know what the players are motivated by, what they need. And once I work that out, then I'll look at other staff bringing in. It's not for me to speak for the Northern Hemisphere, it's for me to speak for England. What we have to do, there are areas in our games that are deficient. We've got to make sure we get the skill and the knowledge in those areas to improve. There's areas in the game that we can that have been strengths that we need to improve on. So you're always doing a gap analysis between where the top sides are, where you are, and then also the other thing you've got to do is look at where the game's going. Because if you want to be the top team in the world, you're going to be playing the sort of rugby everyone wants to play 12 months later. You know, you want the rest of the world to be copying you. So, you know, we've got an idea of what those gaps are and where we need to go.
Any boost?
No, not for you.